Simon & Schuster Audio presents What Looks Like Bravery, An Epic Journey Through Loss to Love by Laurel Braitman. Read by the author.
Many names and some identifying details have been changed, whether or not so noted. For Jake, my 911. I wrote this story with the pen my dad gave me. Prologue. Santa Paula, California, September 1994. It was a warm Saturday afternoon, and the Santa Ana winds ruffled the tops of the avocado trees. I was at home with two good friends, all of us 16 years old, draped like hormonal Dali clocks over the living room furniture while we watched The Bodyguard on VHS and painted our nails. No one was surprised when I knocked over one of the bottles. I paused the movie and went into my parents' bathroom to get the nail polish remover Mom kept under the sink. I glanced at myself in the mirror, disappointed, as usual, by my wild hair, tight cheeks, and how little I look like someone Kevin Costner might want to carry to safety. Kneeling down and reaching into the cabinet, I pushed aside the bottles of rubbing alcohol that Dad used to clean the stump on his amputated leg and the tray of stainless scissors he had brought home from his job at the hospital. I was moving a multi-pack of Dove soap when I saw it, a small plastic pill bottle. It was strange, not labeled like everything else in the cabinet. It didn't look like the transparent orange prescription bottles that came from the pharmacy either. My body sensed danger before my mind did. Something clenched in my chest. My pulse started to throb in my face. There was a handwritten note rubber banded around the bottle. I unrolled it carefully. "No one should have to do this for a friend," it read. "But here you go." My throat went hot and dry as the winds outside. I steadied myself on the cabinet door. It hit me. Dad had a suicide plan, and he kept it in the bathroom like a box of Q-tips or Mom's Velcro rollers. Underneath the message was the name of a drug and dosage instructions written out longhand. I had no idea how long the bottle had been there or when he was going to use it, but I knew I couldn't ask. I could tell no one about this, not even Mom or Jake, not ever. I understood without being told that I wasn't supposed to know Dad had a plan, or that anyone had helped him, or that this was barreling toward us like a car whose brakes had gone out. I let myself feel my pounding terror for just a few more seconds, and then I rewound the note and put the bottle back exactly where it had been. Standing up, I took a long breath, summoning every bit of power I had, and shoved my fear and panic down as hard as I could, burying them so deeply that for the longest time, I thought they were dead and gone. Only, you can't kill feelings. Just like bad boyfriends or lost cats, they tend to come back when you least expect it. Part 1. A man who has not prepared his children for his own death has failed as a father. King T'Chaka, Black Panther. 1. Santa Paula, California. It was 1985. I was 7 years old and had one thing on my mind: saving my family. I went to the library at Mesa Union, my public primary school surrounded by lemon orchards, and told Mary, the librarian, that I was done with my usual ballet books, Laura Ingalls Wilder and the Tales from the Crypt series. Instead, I wanted stories about kids with dead parents, or survival skills. I remember her looking at me curious, but she didn't make me explain. Mary, like my parents, did not believe in age requirements for literature. "How about Island of the Blue Dolphins?" she asked. I'd read it, but I took the book anyway. Then she gave me Julie of the Wolves and told me that I might not understand all of it yet. After school that day, I didn't do what I normally did, play with my dollhouse or stare at the swollen testicles and oozing rashes in the skin disorders book that was up in the loft with the rest of Dad's medical textbooks. Instead, I read. Soon, I was reading before and after school and every night after dinner. I read in the car waiting for Mom at the grocery store. I read outside, sitting on the big hill with our herd of half-wild donkeys, turning brown in the sun. And I read while walking around the ranch where we lived, looking up every once in a while to make sure I didn't walk into an orange tree. My favorite books were about orphan girls. Some could make fire using a bow and pocket lint. Others joined wolf packs to hunt for game. I read these books like they were manuals and I could study their tactics. All so I could do my part in case my younger brother Jake and I had to take up seal hunting to feed ourselves or build a shelter out of lemon bins. One day, I spent a few hours figuring out how long, realistically, we'd be able to survive on the ranch without any outside food or water. If we didn't mind scooping pollywogs out of the stagnant creek or eating Midnight the Pony, this would be a very long time. What I really wanted, though, was something to protect us, especially Dad. I'd said goodbye to him once, but then he'd survived, surprising all of us except maybe himself. It started 4 years before, in 1981. Dad was 41, Mom was 33. I was 3, and my brother hadn't been born yet. Dad's knee hurt. He thought he'd injured himself in a ski accident in Utah. He went to the emergency room there, still in his blue woolen ski sweater. But the on-call physician didn't see anything broken or torn on his x-rays. So Dad flew home, iced his leg, and went back to work as a cardiothoracic surgeon at our county hospital. But the pain got worse instead of better. During the day, he hardly noticed it. But at night, his knee throbbed so badly he couldn't sleep. The only thing that helped was walking. So he'd get out of bed trying not to wake Mom and pace the orchards. Up and down, he went through the rows of new baby avocado trees they'd just planted and the older, taller orange groves. My parents bought the ranch in the spring of 1978. We were living in Camarillo then, a small town named for a Californio, a Spanish-speaking Californian descended from Mexican and Spanish colonizers, who grew lima beans, bred fancy white horses, and was famous for riding around town on a studded silver saddle. My parents owned a small house on a couple acres with a vegetable garden and enough space for Mom's 2 donkeys, a flock of chickens, 4 aloof merino sheep, and me. Dad wanted more space to garden, more animals, more everything. "What if we grew avocados?" Mom remembers him asking as he tamped down the tobacco in his pipe one night after dinner. "Jewish avocado farmers?" she asked. "Ranchers. I don't know why, but no one says avocado farming. It's like they're raising cattle instead of fruit." Mom was skeptical. They were not farming or ranching people. He'd grown up in downtown Baltimore, a few miles from Johns Hopkins, where he'd later go to medical school. She was the daughter of an optometrist in Beverly Hills. But they loved working in the garden and having animals, and they thought it'd be an interesting way to raise a kid. I was born just before Valentine's Day that winter. Mom was worried about bringing me home because Dad didn't want children. At their last house in Oakland, where he'd been working as a doctor in the Navy, he planted New Zealand thorn trees around the perimeter of the yard like a barbed fence so none of the neighborhood kids would be tempted to kick a ball over. He eventually agreed to have a child, not because he wanted one, but because he loved her. When he looked into my eyes for the first time, though, dark as his, with eyebrows like quotation marks, waiting for him to say something worth remembering. Whatever thorn trees he'd planted inside himself were uprooted forever. We didn't know it yet, but we were each other's becoming, loving one another in direct proportion to how much we fought. A mutual crucible to the death. After Mom and Dad's ranching conversation, she started strapping me into my car seat in the afternoons, and driving the long, straight roads along irrigation ditches through strawberry fields and lemon orchards, where farm workers in straw hats and canvas gloves picked fruit, looking for sale signs. She talked to agricultural real estate agents, called up commercial growers to ask advice, and scoured the listings in the local Starfruit Press. When she saw an auction notice for a 50-acre citrus and cattle ranch in Santa Paula, the self-proclaimed citrus capital of the world, a small, mostly Mexican town with a sun-bleached main street, home to a string of panaderias and vaquero supply shops selling crocodile boots, she drove straight there. The ranch was named Los Perules for the giant pepper trees that stood in front of the old farmhouse, their leaves like pale green ostrich feathers drooping toward the ground, hiding the papery pink clusters of peppercorns. The property stretched from the main road all the way to the lip of the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.